美方结束回应之后，就要求现场记者立即离开，没有给杨洁篪和王毅回应美方的机会。
Why did you sanction China before the talk?
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you everyone. Thank you. Thank you everyone. Thank you.
This is not fair.
Thank you.
This is not fair.
Thank you very much.
You have two wrongs. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Can we?
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you. She's like.
现场的美方工作人员在要求记者离开时，当时只是要求中方记者离开，但是在中国代表团据理力争之下，所有的中国记者都全程见证了大约一个半小时的开幕致辞。
无论是从我们国家本身乃至于世界的角度来说呢，都应该清楚地阐明美国的意图以及其政策的一些措施和这个方针。那么也因此，中国的诸多的问题，包括在新疆、香港和台湾的这个议题，以及对美国进行的网络的攻击，还有对于我们的伙伴以及盟国的进行的经济的这种胁迫的这种行为，对于世界的利益来说都是一种损害。我们当然不乐见这些这个问题存在，这不已经不是一个国家的问题乃至是世界的这个问题。我也这个强调过，我们双边的这个关系在可能有的这个竞争的情况下竞争，可以合作的情况下合作，但是如果要对抗的必须要对抗的时候，我们也会直面因此我们在这里今天要讨论的这个问题，包括向贵方介绍美国在诸多工作上面的优先顺序，所以我们非常期待今天和明天与您的讨论，谢谢。
And before turning to you, Mr. Director, I'd like to invite National Security Advisor Sullivan to say a few words.
我在请杨主任讲话之前呢，我想请Sullivan 国安助理讲几句话。
Thank you, Mr. Secretary, and welcome to Director Yang and State Councilor Wong. It's fitting that we're meeting here in Alaska. We may be far from the continental United States, but there are a few places that are as quintessentially American.Big-hearted, resilient, intrepid. This is truly a fitting place for us to host this meeting. Secretary Blinken and I are proud of the story about America we're able to tell here, about a country that under President Biden's leadership has made major strides to control the pandemic, to rescue our economy, and to affirm the strength and staying power of our democracy. We're particularly proud of the work that we've doneto revitalize our alliances and partnerships, the foundation of our foreign policy. Just last week, President Biden hosted the Quad Leaders Summit that spoke to the can-do spirit of the world's democracies and committed to realize the vision of a free and open Indo-Pacific. It is through partnerships like these that all of us can deliver progress and prosperity for our peoples.Secretary Blinken laid out many of the areas of concern, from economic and military coercion to assaults on basic values, that we'll discuss with you today and in the days ahead. We'll do so frankly, directly, and with clarity. These are the concerns that are on the minds of the American people. But it goes beyond that. We've heard each of these concerns from around the world, from our allies and partners,and the broader international community during the intensive consultations we've undertaken these last 2 months. We'll make clear today that our overriding priority on the United States' side is to ensure that our approach in the world and our approach to China benefits the American people and protects the interests of our allies and partners. We do not seek conflict, but we welcome stiff competition, and we will always stand up for our principles, for our people,and for our friends. We look forward to discussing all of these matters with you in the hours ahead. Thank you.
感谢国务卿，我也跟国务卿一道 非常诚实地欢迎杨主任和王国伟到阿拉斯加的访问。尽管呢，阿拉斯加离美国本土呢遥远，但是呢，没有一个州能够像阿拉斯加州那样正确地代表了美国这种敞开怀抱以及呢有韧性的这么一种精神。那么可以说，它在方方面面都代表着美国的精神。那其实，国务卿和我呀，要重新叙述的，就是拜登总统一直强调的这么一个故事。我们可以看到，在很短的时间内，我们这个有效的抗击疫情，同时呢，振兴了经济。那么这很多方面重新振兴了美国的力量和实力。那么可以说这个呢，也是代表了美国的最基本的这个一些这个精神和价值。那拜登总统呢，也体现了他的这个我们有能力做到，而且呢有这种乐观的这个精神的这样的这个政策。在不久之前，我们可以看到这个四方峰会的成功的召开，同时呢，在我们跟盟友一道再次的阐明了我们对于印太的自由开放的这个决心不变。同时呢，这也是一个非常好的机会，向全世界展示了美国的人民以及美国的利益。那么我们可以看到在这个国务卿刚才所提到的这些一系列的这个举措当中呢，也显示了我们对中国的一些做法的关切，这些包括在经济、军事上面，以及呢在民主价值上的一些这个对我们的盟友和朋友的胁迫所以呢，这些也将是我们今天以及接下来的与中方讨论的重要的这个议题。我们认为这些议题其实对于世界不单是美国的关切，也是世界很多这个国家，包括我们的盟友以及朋友的这个关切。在过去的数个月当中，我们与盟友和朋友进行协商的时候，他们都不约而同地向我们提出了这些关切。因此我们必须要阐明这个向世界和中方阐明美国的一些这个做法和美国的想法，进一步的促进和捍卫美国人民的利益。我们呢，很明显会面对这个之间的竞争，而且呢以非常清晰的这个态度阐明我们的这个立场。所以本着这个精神，我期待着今天和以后与中方的讨论。谢谢。
王毅国务委员兼外长应布林肯国务卿沙利文先生的邀请来美国安克雷奇，同你们两位进行战略对话。我们希望这次对话是真诚的、坦率的中美两国呢都是世界的大国，我们对地区和世界的和平稳定和发展都负有重要的责任。中国刚举行的两会通过了第45经济社会发展规划和2035年的远景规划的纲要。中国呢，现在正在处于两个百年目标交汇期。中国到2035年。必将实现基本现代化，到2050年将实现全面 现代化。我们抗疫取得了决定性的胜利，取得了重要的战略的成果。我们脱贫攻坚取得了全面胜利，中国的人均只有美国的六分之一，但是我们做到了使我们极端贫困的人民脱贫了希望其他国家，特别是发达国家，能够做出努力。中国在实现全面小康方面取得的伟大的历史性的成就，中国人民紧密地团结在中国共产党的周围，我们的价值就是人类的价值，那就是和平、发展、公平、正义、自由、民主。我们所遵循的，国际社会所遵循的，是以联合国为核心的国际体系，是以国际法为基础的国际秩序，而不是一小部分国家所鼓吹的以规则为基础的国际秩序。美国有美国的式的民主，中国有中国式的民主。美国的民主不仅由美国人来评价，而且要由世界人民来评价美国的民主到底做得怎么样，不是美国一家说了算了。而中国这些年通过改革开放，中国在各方面都取得了巨大的发展，特别是我们为地区和平和发展，为维护联合国宪章的宗旨和原则做出了不懈的努力。世界上的战争是其他人发动的，造成了很多人生灵涂炭，而中国要求各国走和平发展的道路，应该实行和平的对外政策，而不应该凭借自己的武力到处去进行侵略，去推翻其他国家的合法的政权，去屠杀其他国家的人民造成了世界的动荡不安而这些做法归根结底对美国也是非常不利的所以美国现在需要的是改变自己的形象，而不是推广自己的所谓民主。而美国自己国内现在很多人对美国的民主并没有信心，对美国的政府有各种各样的看法，而在中国根据美国的民意调查，中国的领导人得到了中国人民的普遍的赞扬，所以任何诋毁中国社会制度的做法都是徒劳的。事实已经证明，这种拙劣的做法只会使中国人民更加紧密地团结在中国共产党的周围，沿着我们所制定的目标前进。从1952年开始，我们就实行了第一个5年计划， 现在我们在实行第14个五年计划，我们将一步一步地向前进。中国的发展不仅是要维护中国人民的利益，而且是要为世界在21世纪的发展做出贡献。中美两国都是大国，都负有重要的责任，要为世界的和平、稳定和发展做出贡献。再例如抗疫、复产复工，在应对气候变化等方面，我们有很多的共同利益。人们应该摒弃冷战思维、零和游戏，应该改变自己的思想模式，在21世纪让所有的国家，大小国家，特别是大国，能够团结一心，为人类的未来做出我们的贡献，来构建人类命运共同体，来实现公平、合理、相互尊重啊的新的国际关系。关于在一些地区的问题，我想问题是美国使用凭借自己的武力和金融霸权对其他国家进行长臂管辖，进行打压，滥用所谓国家安全的概念来妨碍正常的贸易往来，而且煽动一些国家对中国进行攻击，而中国根据科学的技术的标准来处理进出口的问题。日本和韩国，你刚访问过的两个国家，恰好是中国的第二大、第三大贸易伙伴。东盟国家现在已经成为中国的第一大贸易伙伴，超过了欧盟，超过了美国，同他们的贸易额。我们希望美国能够在亚太地区同各国发展良好的关系，我们之间应该有很多共同的朋友，这才是在21世纪的处世之道。在春节前夕，习近平主席同拜登总理通了电话，总统通了电话，双方一致同意要加强沟通，管控分歧，拓展合作。我们今天开这个会，也就是要落实两国元首的电话的共识。开这次会也是我们两国元首所决定的。两国人民和世界人民都希望这次会议能够开出务实的成果。新疆、西藏、台湾都是中国领土不可分割的一部分。我们坚决反对美国干涉中国的内政，我们对美国采取的干涉中国内政的行为表示了坚决的反对，并将采取坚定的反应。人权问题，我们希望美国在这方面能做得好一点。中国的人权事业正在不断地取得进展， 我想事实已经说明美国国内的人权确实是存在很多问题的，你们自己也承认这个问题，你们自己也承认在世界上啊，靠武力去解决问题是不行的，你们也自己承认啊，去推翻你们所谓的威权国家使用各种手段是失败的，而美国存在的人权问题是根深蒂固的，不是过去四年就存在的啊，对黑人的屠杀早就存在这个问题，所以我想我们两国啊最好自己管好自己的事儿，不要转移矛头，把国内的问题没解决好转移到国际上去，中国就是要把中国的事情办好，把我们14亿人的人民的生活提高，这就是中国的外交的目标，同时我们要为世界的和平稳定做出自己的贡献。中美两国关系啊，打开冰封时代以后取得了很多的成绩，这是两国有识人士共同努力的结果啊，这个结果是来之不易的，虽然现在国际形势发生了很大的变化，但是有必要我们两国来考虑如何在新的形势下我们来进行合作，扩大合作面。如果说我们之间有竞争的话，那么这些竞争主要还是在经济方面，我说过了，经济的接触当中可能会产生一些矛盾，这些矛盾应该理性的来处理，应该实现共赢。中美的贸易已经取得了很大的成绩，应该再上一层楼。美国在华的企业绝大部分认为中国的营商环境是好的，没有人强迫他们待在那儿，他们愿意在中国，因为他们在中国啊能够得到好处，有他们的广阔的发展天地。我们认为我们两国在新形势下一定要加强相互沟通啊，妥善管理分歧，努力推进合作，我们不应该进行对抗，对抗的年代是有过的，对抗的结果对美国并没有什么好处啊，美国拿到了什么好处？我看什么好处都没有，只是给美国带来了很大的损害。我们中国是挺得过来的，所以我们对中美关系的评价也就是习近平主席讲的，就是要啊，不冲突，不对抗，相互尊重，合作共赢。不冲突不对抗也是拜登总统自己通过电话跟习主席讲的，所以我们在这个层级应该全面的正确的贯彻两国领导人的共识，使得中美关系能够重新回到健康稳定发展的轨道上来。谢谢。
Secretary。
王爷，你说两句吧。
我先翻译一下。
还要翻吗？翻吧你。
那我先翻一下。
It's a test. for the interpreter.
We're going to give the translator a raise.
Yeah.
Secretary Blinken and Mr. Sullivan, the State Councilor and the Foreign Minister Wang Yi and I have come to encourage the United States to have this strategic dialogue with the United States. We hope that this dialogue will be a sincere and candid one. Both China and the United States are major countries in the world, and together we shoulder important responsibilities to the peace, stability, and development of the world and the region. In China, we have just concluded the Lianghui, or the two sessions of the National People's Congress and the Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference. During the sessions, we adopted the outline for the 14th Five-Year Economic and Social Development Plan and the long-range objectives through the year 2035. For China, we are now in a historic year where we will move from finishing the first centenary goal to the second centenary goal. And by the year 2035, China will surely achieve basic modernization. And by the year 2050, China will achieve full modernization. China has made decisive achievements and important strategic gains in fighting COVID-19, and we have achieved a full victory in ending absolute poverty in China. China's per capita GDP is only one-sixth of that of the United States, but we have managed to end absolute poverty for all people in China. And we hope that other countries, especially the advanced countries, will make similar efforts in this regard. And China has also made historic achievement in building the country into a moderately prosperous one in all respects. The Chinese people are closely rallying around the Communist Party of China. Our values are the same as the common values of humanity. Those are peace, development, fairness, justice, freedom, and democracy. What China and the international community follow or uphold is the United Nations-centered international system and the international order underpinned by international law, not what is advocated by a small number of countries of the so-called rules-based international order. And the United States has its styled United States-styled democracy, and China has the Chinese-styled democracy. It is not just up to the American people, but also the people of the world, to evaluate how the United States has done in advancing its own democracy. In China's case, after decades of reform and opening up, we have come a long way in various fields. In particular, we have made tireless efforts to contribute to the peace and the development of the world and to upholding the purposes and principles of the UN Charter. The wars in this world are launched by some other countries, which have resulted in massive casualties. But for China, what we have asked for other countries, is to follow a path of peaceful development. And this is the purpose of our foreign policy. We do not believe in invading through the use of force or to topple other regimes through various means or to massacre the people of other countries because all of those would only cause turmoil and instability in this world. And at the end of the day, all of those would not serve the United States well. So we believe that it is important for the United States to change its own image and to stop advancing its own democracy in the rest of the world. Many people within the United States actually have little confidence in the democracy of the United States, and they have various views regarding the government of the United States. In China, according to opinion polls, the leaders of China have the wide support of the Chinese people. So, no attempt to...
美国的民调.
The opinion polls conducted in the United States show that the leaders of China have the support of the Chinese people. No attempt to smear China's social system would get anywhere. Facts have shown that such practices would only lead the Chinese people to rally more closely around the Communist Party of China and work steadily towards the goals that we have set for ourselves. In 1952, China adopted its first five-year development plan, and now we are into the first year of the 14th five-year development plan. We will continue along this path step by step. China's development is not just about delivering benefits for the people of China, but also about contributing to the development of the world in the 21st century. China and the United States are both major countries and both shoulder important responsibilities. We must both contribute to the peace, stability, and the development of the world. In areas such as COVID-19, restoring economic activities in the world, and responding to climate change, there are many things that we can do together and where our interests converge. So what we need to do is to abandon the Cold War mentality and the zero-sum game approach. We must change the way we think and make sure that in this century, the 21st century, countries big or small, particularly the big countries, should come united together to contribute to the future of humanity and build a community with a shared future for humankind. It's also important for all of us to come together to build a new type of international relations featuring fairness, justice, and mutual respect. And on some regional issues, I think the problem is that the United States has exercised long-arm jurisdiction and suppression and overstretched the national security through the use of force or financial hegemony. And this has created obstacles for normal trade activities. And the United States has also been persuading some countries to launch attacks on China. And as for China, we believe and we have handled import and export related issues according to scientific and technological standards. Secretary Blinken, you said you just came back from Japan and the ROK. Those two countries are China's second and third largest trading partners. ASEAN has now become China's largest trading partner, overtaking the European Union and the United States. So we do hope that the United States will develop sound relations with all countries in the Asia-Pacific. We should have many mutual friends. This is the right way forward in the 21st century. On the eve of the Chinese Lunar New Year, President Xi Jinping and President Joe Biden had a phone conversation. The two presidents agreed to step up communication, manage differences, and expand cooperation between our two countries. We are having this dialogue today to follow up on the common understandings of the two presidents reached during their phone conversation. And having this dialogue is, in fact, a decision made by the two presidents. So for the people of the two countries and the world, they're hoping to see practical outcomes coming out of our dialogue. And for Xinjiang, Tibet, and Taiwan, they are inalienable part of China's territory. China is firmly opposed to U.S. interference in China's internal affairs. We have expressed our staunch opposition to such interference, and we will take firm actions in response. On human rights, we hope that the United States will do better on human rights. China has made steady progress in human rights, and the fact is that there are many problems within the United States regarding human rights, which is admitted by the U.S. itself as well. The United States has also said that countries can't rely on force in today's world to resolve the challenges we face. And it is a failure to use various means to topple the so-called authoritarian states. And the challenges facing the United States in human rights are deep-seated. They did not just emerge over the past 4 years, such as Black Lives Matter. It did not come up only recently. So we do hope that for our two countries, it's important that we manage our respective affairs well, instead of deflecting the blame on somebody else in this world. And for China, we will manage our own affairs well, and we hope to deliver a better life for our 1.4 billion Chinese people. This is the goal of China's diplomacy. And also, we will make our contribution to the peace and stability of the world. Since breaking the ice between our two countries in our engagement several decades ago, China and the United States have achieved a lot together. This is the result of the concerted efforts of the people with vision of both countries, and this has been hard-won achievements. Although so much has changed in this world, it is important that our two countries think about how we can work together and expand our cooperation under the new circumstances. If there is competition between our two countries, I think the competition focuses on the economic aspect. And in this area, as I have said just now, for frictions in our economic engagement, it is important to respond to them in a rational way and seek win-win results. And China-U.S. trade has already achieved a lot, and we should do even better. The overwhelming majority of American businesses in China have said that China's business environment is good, and nobody has forced them to stay in China. They see a profit coming from their presence in China, and they see immense opportunities in China. That's why they are here in China. And I believe that for our two countries, under the new circumstances, we need to enhance communication, properly manage our differences, and expand our cooperation instead of engaging in confrontation. Well, between our two countries, we've had confrontation in the past, and the result did not serve the United States well. What did the United States gain from that confrontation? I didn't see any. And the only result was damages done to the United States. And China will pull through and has pulled through such confrontation. So the way we see the relationship with the United States is, as President Xi Jinping has said, that is, we hope to see no confrontation, no conflict, mutual respect, and win-win cooperation with the United States. And actually, during the phone call between the presidents, President Biden himself also talked about the importance of having no conflict or confrontation between our two countries. So at our level, I think it's vital that we do everything we can to fully and faithfully follow up and implement the understandings reached between our two presidents and bring back China-U.S. relationship to the track of sound and steady growth. 所谓这个网络袭击问题，我想想，网络袭击的能力啊，使用方面，美国都是冠军。On cyber attacks, let me say that whether it's the ability to launch cyber attacks or the technologies that could be deployed, the United States is the champion in this regard.
倒打一把是不行的。
Well, you can't blame this problem on somebody else.
美国不代表国际舆论。
The United States itself does not represent international public opinion.
西方也不代表国际舆论。
And neither does the Western world.
无论是从人数上来讲，还是从世界潮流来讲，西方的愚人不能被认为是国际愚人。
Whether judged by population scale or the trend of the world, the Western world does not represent the global public opinion.
所以我们希望美国在讲什么普世价值啊，什么国际舆论的时候啊，想想自己啊心里是不是踏实，因为你们不能够代表，你们只能代表美国政府。
So we hope that when talking about universal values or international public opinion on the part of the United States, we hope the U.S. side will think about whether it feels reassured saying those things because the U.S. does not represent the world, it only represents the government of the United States.
我认为世界上绝大部分国家不承认美国所说的普遍价值，不承认美国的言论就是国际舆论，不承认少数人制定的规则就是所谓以规则为基础的啊国际秩序。
I don't think the overwhelming majority of countries in the world would recognize that the universal values advocated by the United States, or that the opinion of the United States could represent international public opinion. And those countries would not recognize that the rules made by a small number of people would serve as the basis for the international order.
因为两位的开场白与众不同，所以我的开场白恐怕跟一般的开场白也稍稍不同。
Oh, because Mr. Secretary and NSA Sullivan, you have delivered some quite different opening remarks. Mine would be slightly different as well.
Okay. Yeah. Yang 主任刚才讲比较长，我会讲的短一点。
Well, I will stay quite brief compared with Director Yang.
两位先生，你们跟中国也打过多年的交道，也算是我们的朋友了。那么很高兴今天能够见面。中方是应美方的邀请而来。安卡德基这个地方，就像刚才沙利文所讲的，处在中美航线的中间的位置，所以可以说这个地方既是中美交往的一个加油站，也是我们两国相向而行的一个交汇点。过去几年，由于中国的正当的权益受到了无理的打压，中美关系遭遇到了前所未有的严重的困难。这种局面损害了两国人民的利益，也损害了世界的稳定和发展，不应当再继续下去了。中方过去、今后、将来都绝不会接受美国方面的无端的指责。同时，我们要求美方要放弃动辄干涉中国内政的这种霸权的行径，这个老毛病应该改一改了。我尤其要在这里指出的是，就在3月17号，美方竟然在涉及到香港问题上再次升级对中国的所谓的制裁。这种粗暴干涉中国内政的行径激起了中国人民的强烈的愤慨，我们当然坚决的予以反对。安卡提这个地方虽然是中美的中间点，但毕竟是美国，我们适应美国的邀请 到这里来。但是竟然在我们出发的前一天，美国发起新的对华制裁，我认为这不是正常的待客之道。但如果美方试图以此举来所谓增强你们对华的优势的话，我想恐怕也是打错了算盘，只能证明内心的虚弱和无力，丝毫不会影响中国的正当的立场，也不会动摇中国人民的意志。我最后要说的是，习近平主席和拜登总统在中国春节出席的通话非常重要，他们而达成的共识为中美关系重回正轨指明了方向。国际社会高度关注今明两天我们在这里的对话，高度关注双方能否各自显示出诚意和善意，能否从这里向世界发出积极和正面的信号。我们对此拭目以待，如果美方愿意的话，我们愿意共同把这份责任承担起来，把我们应该做的工作做好。我就说这些，谢谢。
Secretary Blinken, NSA Sullivan, you have been involved in the relationship with China for many years, so you're also true friends for the Chinese people. And I would say that I'm pleased to meet you today. And China, the Chinese delegation is here at the invitation of the United States. And as NSA Sullivan said, Anchorage is the midpoint of the air route connecting our two countries. And it is fair to say that this place is a refueling station for China-U.S. exchanges and also a place that China and the United States can meet each other halfway. And China certainly in the past has not and in the future will not accept the unwarranted accusations from the U.S. side. In the past several years, China's legitimate rights and interests have come under outright suppression, plunging the China-U.S. relationship into a period of unprecedented difficulty. This has damaged the interests of our two peoples and taken its toll on world stability and development. And this situation must no longer continue. And China urges the U.S. side to fully abandon the hegemonic practice of willfully interfering in China's internal affairs. This has been a long-standing issue, and it should be changed. It is time for it to change. And in particular, on the 17th of March, the United States escalated its so-called sanctions on China regarding Hong Kong. And the Chinese people are outraged by this gross interference in China's internal affairs, and the Chinese side is firmly opposed to it. Anchorage is a midpoint between China and the United States, but after all, it's still the United States territory. And I have said that the Chinese delegation has come here at the invitation of the United States. However, just on the day before our departure, the United States passed these new sanctions. This is not supposed to be the way one should welcome his guests. And we wonder if this is a decision made by the United States to try to gain some advantage in dealing with China. But certainly this is miscalculated and only reflects the vulnerability and weakness inside the United States. And this will not shake China's position or resolve on those issues. And let me also say that the phone conversation that President Xi Jinping and President Biden had on the eve of the Chinese New Year is a very important one. And during this phone conversation, they reached some common understandings that have pointed the way forward for us to bring back the China-U.S. relationship onto the right track. And the international community is following very closely our dialogue for today and tomorrow. They're watching whether our two sides will each demonstrate goodwill and sincerity, and they are watching whether this dialogue will send out a positive signal to the world. So we will be watching what will happen today and tomorrow. And if the United States is willing, I think our two sides should step up to this responsibility and deliver on this task that we are given. I will stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hold on one second, please. Mr. Director, State Counselor, given your extended remarks, permit me please to add just a few of my own before we get down to work, and I know Mr. Sullivan may have a few things to say as well. I have to tell you, in my short time as Secretary of State, I've spoken to, I think, nearly 100 counterparts from around the world, and I just made my first trip, as I noted, to Japan and South Korea. I have to tell you, what I'm hearing is very different from what you described. I'm hearing deep satisfaction that the United States is back, that we're reengaged with our allies and partners. I'm also hearing deep concern about some of the actions your government is taking, and we'll have an opportunity to discuss those when we get down to work. A hallmark of our leadership, of our engagement in the world, is our alliances and our partnerships that have been built on a totally voluntary basis. And it is something that President Biden is committed to reinvigorating and strengthening. And there's one more hallmark of our leadership here at home. And that's a constant quest to, as we say, form a more perfect union. And that quest, by definition, acknowledges our imperfections, acknowledges that we're not perfect, we make mistakes, we have reversals, we take steps back. But what we've done throughout our history is to confront those challenges openly, publicly, transparently, not trying to ignore them, not trying to pretend they don't exist, not trying to sweep them under a rug. And sometimes it's painful, sometimes it's ugly, but each and every time we've come out stronger, better, more united as a country. I recall well when President Biden was vice president and we were visiting China, and this was in the wake of the financial crisis. There was much discussion then, including with then Vice President Xi Jinping. And Vice President Biden at the time said, it's never a good bet to bet against America. And that remains true today.
感谢。那么因为啊，杨主任和王国伟呢都讲了很长的这个讲话，所以我这里呢也想补充几句。我相信Sullivan 国安助理呢也会接着讲几句话。那么尽管呢我在任上的时间并不长，但是呢我在世界范围内跟超过100个这个国家相关的人员呢通过话。那么您也知道，我第一次的出访呢是日本和韩国，所以呢，我从他们那儿听到的跟您讲的是大不相同的，因为他们呢都表示了非常的不满，同时呢非常高兴美国重新回来了，而对于中国还在很多方面呢都表示了深刻的关切。那么这个当然就是我们接下来要讨论的一些内容。那么其实在世界上美国所体现的这么一种领导力可以说也就是从这个世界范围内我们的盟邦也好，或者呢是朋友也好，在跟我们一道呢都是出于自愿的，就好像拜登总统曾经强调过的，其实美国有一个特质，
那么其中呢，就是我们承认，也是我们常说的，美国并不是一个已经完美的联邦，也就是说我们可以做得更好。我们承认自己并不完美，我们也曾经犯过错误，而且呢也有往倒退的时候。但是纵观美国的历史，我们都是以公开的、开放的、透明的方式来处理这些问题，我们并不回避，我们也没有这个假装它不存在，或者呢把它扫在一个角落里头不去处理。在这个过程当中呢是非常痛苦的，而且呢也是非常艰难的。但是每一次在我们克服了这些困难之后，美国作为一个国家显得更加强大，人民更加团结，国家更加美好。那么我记得在这个金融危机的时候呢，拜登总统当时也访问了中国，与当时的副主席习近平先生有过很多的这个接触和对话。其中啊，他非常这个严肃地说过一句话，打赌美国不行，一定是输的。
Just briefly to add to what Secretary Blinken has said, because I was actually going to make the same point without us even consulting. A confident country is able to look hard at its own shortcomings and constantly seek to improve. And that is the secret sauce of America. The other secret sauce of America is that our people are a problem-solving people, and we believe that we solve problems best when we work together with allies and partners around the world. Just a couple of weeks ago, the United States landed another rover on Mars. And it wasn't just an American project. It had technology from multiple countries, from Europe and other parts of the world. And it is also going to leave behind a collection of material from Mars that the United States and Europe will build a device that can fly there to pick it up and bring it back. That is what can be accomplished by a country that is constantly reinventing itself, working closely with others, and seeking constantly to produce the kind of progress that benefits all, that is rooted in a concept of human dignity and human rights that is truly universal, that every man, woman, and child in this world aspires to. So we look forward to the conversation today, but I do hope this conversation will be one carried out with confidence on both sides. So it's not lectures or long, winding statements. It's the opportunity for us to explain where we're coming from, to hear where you are coming from, and to indicate at bottom what our principles, our priorities, and our long-term strategies are. That's what we hope for in the dialogue that lies ahead. That is the spirit with which we approach this, and we look forward to continuing the discussion today. Thank you, everybody.
这样我呢也想接着讲几句话。其实我要讲的话呢，国务卿刚才呢几乎都这个讲过了。但是呢我要说明的是，其实啊，一个真正有自信的国家，就是呢能够直面它的缺点，而且呢希望能够不断完善、精益求精的这个国家。这个可以说也是美国成功的秘诀。那么另外的一个秘诀呢，就是美国人民是一个善于解决问题的人民，尤其呢善于与这个朋友和这个盟友一起解决问题。那么前几个星期前呢，我们的这个火星探索器在火星的表面降落。其实这个不单是含有美国的技术，它也有来自世界各国，包括欧洲一些国家的这个技术。那么我们呢将会在火星这个收集一些这个样本。那么这个之后呢，通过与欧洲的合作，重新返回火星，把这些样本呢带回地球。我们之所以能够做到这一点，就是体现了我们是一个能够不断的去自我创造，而且呢是能够跟别人共事合作，而且呢为所有的人取得进步的这么一个这个国家。我们呢非常尊重人的尊严、人权 因此呢，我们希望能够让所有的这个人呢都能够这个获益。其实我们的这个要进行的对话，并不是我们这个各说各话，或者是长篇大论的进行这种言辞的表述，而是呢真正的体现我们双方自己的这个信心。同时呢，他也给我们这么一个机会来解释我们既所以有这些想法的这个原因，也倾听对方的这个表述也就是呢，尤其是长远的战略的这个角度呢进行这个介绍。所以我是本着这样的精神来期待我们今明两天的讨论。谢谢。
我也想